Welcome to the video lecture series on sociology. I am Dr. Anubhuti Yadav. Today we'll be discussing four concepts from class 11 textbook, that is Introducing Sociology. And these concepts are defining sociology, sociology and philosophical reflection, sociology and common sense, and sociology as a science. Coming on to defining sociology, there are number of definitions on sociology given by a number of sociologists. And till now, there is no definition which can be said that it is acceptable to all. There are number of sociologists, they have, you know, different school of thoughts, and they have given number of definition to explain sociology as a discipline. So now let's have a look at some of the definitions given by the noted sociologists. These are all influential sociologists who played a major role in forming sociology as a discipline which we know today. So now let's come on to the first definition, which is given by Auguste Comte. Now Auguste Comte is considered to be the father of sociology because he was the one who coined the word sociology. Sociology as a term, it's a hybrid term. It consists of two terms from two different languages. Socius in Latin means a company and the companion, and the logos means science and knowledge. Now, if we look at the word and if we look at the meaning of the word, then the sociology means the science of a society. But when we come to the definition given by Auguste Comte, sociology is the science of social phenomena subject to laws and invariable laws. And he said, you know, Auguste Comte said very clearly that the way we study natural phenomena in a scientific manner, similarly, the society needs to be studied in the same manner. And he says that the way natural phenomena are subjected to certain laws, similarly, the social phenomena are also subjected to the various laws. Now, he said very clearly, you know, when he discussed and when he gave the definition of sociology and when he was working on this particular field, he said that the natural science established itself in, you know, framing the lawfulness of the natural phenomena. And he says that, you know, whatever happens, whether it's falling of an object or whether it's the movement of the planets, you know, they follow an ordered sequence of development. And he said that, you know, the similar thing happened in society also, and it should be studied in the same manner. And he very clearly said that, you know, the sociology should be patterned in line with the natural sciences, not in terms of the scientific inquiry, but also the purpose it serves. And he says very clearly that, you know, when we talk about sociology, it should not be only the knowledge of the theoretical things, you know, what needs to be studied and how things happen in the society, but it also, you know, tells, and it also should find out, you know, what purpose it plays in a society and how it will be beneficial for the humankind. So this is what Auguste Comte talked about sociology, and he says that sociology is a science of social phenomena. The second definition which we'll be talking about is given by Emile Durkheim, and he says that sociology is a science of social institution, and he says that the society consists of different parts, different structures, and these parts and structures, they work in coordination with each other. Emily believed that there are boundaries on behavior, and these boundaries on behavior bring society to a consensus. Now, these boundaries on behavior are the customs, morals, values, and he says very clearly that, you know, it happens in a society, and a time comes in a society when these boundaries break. And this intervening period between, you know, when the one value is discarded and the second values are not performed, he called this period as a period of chaos. Now, he says that this period could be brief and it could be a long period. So what Durkheim talks about sociology is that it's an institution of social structure. The third definition is given by Max Weber, and he says that sociology is a science which attempts at, you know, the study of social action. And when he talks about social action, he says that there are four social actions, and these are the actions, you know, of the individuals in the society, And these actions are very important for any society to run smoothly. And these actions are the purposeful rational action. Now, the purposeful rational action where the means and goals are rational, which means that you have a rational goal, and to achieve that rational goal, you employ certain rational means to achieve those goals. Then the second is the value-oriented action. Now, the value-oriented action means that you have a very substantive rational goal, but the means which you have to achieve those particular goal, it might not be rational. Say, for example, when we talk about salvation or spiritualism. Now, the third is the effective action. The effective action is anchored in the emotions of a person. Whatever decision you take, it depends upon the emotion of an individual. It depends upon an emotion of group in a society. And the fourth is traditional action. And the traditional action, which means that it is anchored in, the rituals, beliefs of a one particular society. So this is what Max Weber talks about, and he says that, sociology is a science of, social action. The fourth definition is by the Karl Marx, and his definition is actually, rests in the conflict theory. And he views that in any society and at any point of time, there is a conflict between the classes. Say, for example, there is a conflict between a working class or a rich class, upper middle class. And he says that these conflicts actually bring about social changes, and these social changes can be beneficial to society, and at times it can be violent for a society. So he says that in a conflict theory, this conflict is the most important thing, and the definition which Karl Marx gave about society and sociology is like this. According to Karl Marx, society is comprised of a moving balance of antithetical forces that generate social change by their tension and struggle. For him, struggle rather than peaceful growth was the engine of progress. Strife was the father of all things, and social conflict was the core of historical process. Now, when we carefully examine all these definitions, we can easily make out that, there is no one opinion on defining sociology in one way. And when we look at these definitions carefully, we can also find out one very important thing, and that is that, it is their approach to study this particular discipline. But there is one thing which is common in all definitions, and that is, when we talk about sociology, it is the study of human being. It's a study of, its relationship in the society. It's a study of society, and it's a study of, their interaction in that particular society. So if we have to define sociology in a very general way, we can say that the sociology is the study of human being, their social life, and society. And the objective of it is to study our own behavior as a social being. So these are the different definitions given by the different sociologists. Now, let's talk about sociology and philosophical reflection. Now, when we talk about society and when we talk about study of society and human beings, this is not the first time it has happened. It's not only the sociologists who have started studying human behavior. It has happened in the past also. And many philosophers and many religious thinkers, they have actually talked about this issue and they studied this. But what makes sociology different from philosophical reflection is that when we talk about philosophical reflection, the focus is more on, what is moral for an individual and what is immoral for an individual, what is good in a society and what is better way of living. But when we talk about sociology, sociology studies, individual or people, what they are doing exactly at that point of time in a society. This is what we study in sociology. Now, coming on to sociology and common sense, many a times it happens that, when the people go out and the sociologists study a phenomena, there are a number of people who say that it's a very natural thing, why do we have to study that? But when we talk about common sense, yes, it's very naturalistic, it's very individualistic. And actually, the problem with the common sense is that, we never question our own viewpoint, which means that why do I hold this view? If I say that, there are many poor people in Delhi, So like I never question why do I hold this view. The moment I start questioning that particular view, then it becomes a sociological study. And there is a scientific way of studying, you know, all these social phenomena. Now let's discuss this naturalistic way of, you know, explaining a one particular phenomena and the sociological way of explaining a one particular phenomena. And let's take the example of poverty. Now the natural way of explaining it could be that the person is poor because he comes from a disturbed family, he is not intelligent, he doesn't have a job, or he doesn't want to work. But the sociological way of explaining could be that, you know, the contemporary poverty is because of inequality in society, or the poverty is because of, you know, the chronic irregularity of work. Now, let's come on to sociology as a science. We have actually discussed that, you know, the sociology breaks away from the philosophical reflection, and it also breaks away from the commonsensical knowledge. So what exactly sociologists do? You know, it's a science. And when we say that the sociology is a science, which means that it employs a scientific method to understand any social phenomena. When we talk about scientific method, I mean, it starts exactly with, you know, what is the problem? There should be an identification of problem, why that particular problem exists. And then we come on to, you know, the review of literature, which is there are a lot of studies done on that particular issue or that particular problem. So a sociologist or a researcher, they try to find out what exactly has already been researched about that phenomena. They review that literature in detail, and based on that particular review, they formulate their hypothesis. Now, hypothesis is an assumption which we make. Say, for example, when we talk about, you know, the impact of electronic media on youth, we may say that, you know, the aggressive behavior of youth is due to the violent programs which they are watching on television. So this is a kind of assumption, this is a kind of hypothesis, and we actually formulate such hypothesis in any research process. And we try and test these hypotheses. Sometimes, you know, this hypothesis of ours, I mean, it's correct, and sometimes it is incorrect, but this is what we actually test during a research process. After that, we come on to a research design. The research design is the conceptual framework which tells us very clearly what you want to collect, how you're going to collect that particular data, what time do you have at disposal, what is your budget, what skills, you know, the researcher should have. And once our research design is at place, then we go in the field and gather data. Now, gathering data is also a very important thing because it has to be very scientific. And once the data is collected, you know, this data is analyzed. So this is what, you know, sociologists do if they really want to make their study a scientific study. Now, this is all about sociology, and we defined sociology. We talked about sociology and philosophical reflection. We talked about sociology and common sense. And we talked about sociology as a science. Regarding sociology as a science, we have just discussed it. And maybe in another lecture, we'll discuss this thing in detail. And if you want to read more on these particular concepts, there are certain books which we would like to recommend. And these books are What is Sociology? An Introduction to the Discipline by Alex. The Practice of Sociology by Maitri Chaudhary. Ideology and Theory in Indian Sociology by Yogendra Singh. And as we said in our previous programs, also sociology means that you have to observe things happening around you. So keep observing, keep sharing whatever is happening in the society and around you. We have created a Google group for you, so you can share your views. You can start a debate on any of the issues there. So keep observing and keep sharing. Thank you.